Okay, hi. How are we? This is the last one before the closing keynote, so how are we all feeling?
Woo!
Yes, good. Thank you for coming. Okay, let's hope that this works. Not yet. There, okay, cool. Anyway, I'm Lily Ryan. This is how you spell my name. And find me on Twitter. Okay, but before I get into this, I want to give you all a heads up that we are going to be talking a bit about death. And if this is not a topic that you want to hear about right now, you have my absolute full permission to leave and go and get a coffee, go to the other talk, because this is two tracks, you can do that. That's fine, I will not be mad if you do not want to hear about this kind of topic. But for those of you who are keen to stick around, let's talk about deadly bugs. So, like a lot of us here, I love bugs. I have worked on the bug hunting side, and these days, the things I get paid to do are more, oh crap, the thing that I wrote contains a bug side. But even when I find a bug in my own code, I'm more likely to be thrilled that I learned how it was created, and then I get to squish it instead of feeling sad that I wrote one. And I love the way that you are forced to think creatively to find bugs. I love asking questions. Most importantly, I love that bug hunting allows me to be a professional cynic and to know that there are almost going to certainly be bugs in something if I look hard enough. The way that I start out finding bugs hasn't changed, even though my roles have changed over the years. I ask, what if? Every time I start a new project, or I'm handed a new set of requirements for a piece of work, or something's just not working right, one of the first things I do, after I understand what we actually want this work to achieve, is to work out what we don't want it to do. The question of what if can lead to all kinds of interesting things, and some of them are going to be wild and irrelevant, but some of them are going to be things that you wonder why you didn't think of earlier. And hopefully you'll think of these things and catch all of these bugs before any of them get a chance to do anything nasty. This chunk of metal was one of my first experiences of the value of what if. I attended university at Monash University, which is in Melbourne, in Australia. And some of you folks here may have already also gone there, so you might know this. But anyway, in front of the Civil Engineering Building at Monash University, there's this nice garden where we like to go and drink coffee and not attend lectures. And in the center of this garden, there are these huge twisted chunks of metal, these ones. These pieces of metal came from the Westgate Bridge, which was opened in 1978. This bridge connects the western half of the city of Melbourne to the eastern half, and I use that bridge almost every single day because I live in the west and I work in the east. But in 1970, when the bridge was under construction, it collapsed completely and it killed 35 workers. Some of the people who were killed were working on top of the bridge when it collapsed, and others were killed by some of the twisted metal that I used to drink coffee next to. It fell on the portable building where they were having lunch, and it crushed them all. Monash University bought some of these bits of metal and installed them in the garden in front of the Department of Civil Engineering to remind all of the people who studied there of the consequences of their mistakes. It was a pretty dramatic way to do it, but it certainly gets the point across, and it's like one of the few things that I still remember from being at uni. Anyway, this is a strong symbol for civil engineers, but those of us who work with software often fall into a different category of engineering. When things go wrong with software, it's not so easy to take a piece of that disaster and put it in the middle of a garden for future software and security engineering students to contemplate and think about and drink coffee next to. So I wrote this talk for you instead. It's not going to go in a garden, but hopefully it'll give you a few things to look at when you're doing your own engineering. And when I'm done talking, hopefully you'll have some extra techniques to help you avoid the software equivalent of things like this. It's tricky to define what a software disaster looks like, but I'm going to give you a few examples to try and paint a picture. Some of you, if you formally studied computer science at any rate, I didn't, might have had a course or at least a lecture about historical cases of poorly designed programs that caused disasters. Courses like this tend to focus on what they call safety critical systems. So these are things like medical systems and nuclear power systems and railway signaling systems, important infrastructure-y things. These kinds of courses usually include famous historical examples of software screw-ups like the Therac 25. This was a state-of-the-art radiation treatment machine for cancer patients in the late 1980s. And a combination of software errors in the operating system of this machine led to some patients receiving doses of radiation up to 10 times what they should have received, which caused their early deaths. This was due to a misplaced decimal point in the software. Another common example that gets given in these courses is the London ambulance disaster of 1992. This was due to a new release of the software that London's ambulance services used to send ambulances to people who had called for one. And the software that they delivered that month was full of bugs within pretty much every level of the development process. And for 2 days in the October of 1992, after this big new software release, ambulances simply failed to show up when they were called. And this thing, this bug, has been linked to, this series of bugs, has been linked to the deaths of anywhere from 10 to 20 people, depending on which studies about it that you read. Both of these stories, the London ambulance disaster and the Therac 25, have gone down in history as software problems that we never want to have happen again. But the problem is that outside of these introductory computer science courses, and outside of the medical industry in particular, these stories don't really come up again in our everyday work. The London ambulance disaster was really bad, but a lot of us work on websites for cleaning companies and art galleries, or we maintain databases for online t-shirt printing services, and some of us build mobile games, stuff like that. And these are really important, and they help people, and they bring joy to people's lives. But they don't control medical equipment or decide who gets an ambulance in an emergency. And if they fail to function, a company might lose money, and the team or the CISO might get fired. But really, at the end of the day, nobody's going to die because of some code, except when they do. Let me tell you about these two people. In late 2007, these two people died because of a Unicode localization support bug. This is Amin and Ramazan Çalçıban. They were a Turkish couple, and they were in the middle of a pretty messy divorce. Amin had moved out from where she was living with Ramazan and back in with her family. And in the middle of an argument over SMS, Ramazan told Amin, "You change the topic every time you get backed into a corner," which is a fairly normal thing that someone might say if they were having an argument. The Turkish word for being backed into a corner or being trapped in something uses the dotless I, which is a very common letter in the Turkish alphabet. Unfortunately, it means phone software didn't support the dotless I, so she saw it as a dotted I. And the same word in Turkish for being backed into a corner means something very different and also extremely rude, which would violate the code of conduct if I said it, so I'm not going to, if it uses a dotted I. So when Amin received it, she believed that Ramazan was accusing her of something that she found extremely offensive. And she was upset by this, and she showed the message to her father, who, She showed the message to her father, who is even more upset by this. Can you still hear me? Yeah? Okay? Cool. Awesome.
Hopefully that's okay.
Okay. All right, so I've left you all in suspense. All right. She showed the message to her father. He was even more upset. They decided they were going to call Ramazan over to their house to talk to him about the message. And when he got there, Amin and her sisters attacked him with a bunch of knives, as soon as he opened the door. And during the struggle, Ramazan managed to grabbed one of the knives and ended up stabbing Amin with it, and she died at the scene. She basically bled out right there. Ramazan was arrested, and he died by his own hand in prison shortly afterwards. In 2009, a GPS error killed an 11-year-old boy. So the boy, whose name was Carlos Sanchez, and his mother, whose name was Alicia, they had planned an overnight camping trip in Death Valley in California in the United States. And they used GPS to find their way to the campsite. Unfortunately, the GPS software was following directions that had been programmed into it by a map that had been out of date for decades. and it directed them down a series of side roads and eventually into an animal burrow where the car got stuck. So because these two had only planned an overnight camping trip, they had only brought about enough food and water to last them 2 days. And they hadn't given anyone precise information about where they were going because the trip was supposed to be so short. Because it was an overnight trip, they had also only planned to stay overnight, and they hadn't prepared for the conditions during daytime in Death Valley in summer where it can hit 50 degrees Celsius as a matter of routine every single day. And unfortunately for the Sanchez family, it was 5 days before anyone came to that part of the park and found out what had happened to them, by which time Carlos had died from dehydration. In July 2016, color detection software contributed to the death of a 40-year-old man. So Joshua Brown was driving his Tesla car in autopilot mode down a highway in Florida in the United States. Tesla's autopilot feature isn't quite the same thing as a self-driving car. It can detect dangerous situations like a car approaching too closely, and it can act accordingly to avoid an accident, but it doesn't mean that the driver should take their hands off the wheel. It's not magic. Autopilot was mostly configured for noticing things like what the lines on the road look like and what the front and the back of a car looks like, things like that. And Mr. Brown was approaching an intersection where a large truck was driving perpendicular to him. And the camera in the car couldn't distinguish the white color of the side of the truck from the white that it saw of the sky above it, and it also wasn't set up to recognize what the side of a truck looked like. Unfortunately, Mr. Brown didn't notice the truck either, and neither he nor the autopilot applied the brakes in time to stop the car going through the side of the truck, and it killed him. In telling you stories like this, I don't mean to imply that any of these technologies are in themselves inherently dangerous. You know, more lives, I think, have been saved than have been lost because things like SMS and GPS and autopilot exist. They're built because we're trying to do good things for the world. And every single one of these cases that I just mentioned led to inquiries and audits and system changes, which made it less likely that anything like it would ever happen again. Death really sucks, and no one wants to cause it, basically. But why are these things problems for us, really? Like, we're pen testers and developers and policy writers and blue teamers, and there's a lot of things that we could say to refute the idea that any of this stuff was our fault. Nobody in any of these incidents was actively writing malicious code, and maybe these deaths might not have even happened if the person who read the text had reacted differently to what they'd read, or if the person who was following the GPS had decided to turn back the way that they'd come instead of going further onward into the desert, or if the driver of the Tesla car had hit the brakes himself instead of assuming that the car was going to do it for him. But the plain fact here is that the people who use these things trust us. Like, actually, mostly they really do. They believe in the work that they're doing, that we're doing, and they believe in the goodness of our intentions. And sometimes they pay for this belief with their lives. We are people who have front row seats to the way that software is built, and we know better than anyone else that software is never perfect, and it's not magic, it really isn't. It's written and tested by human beings, just like everything else. But people outside of this industry don't always think like that. And our marketers try their hardest to get people to believe that we are magicians, and we can do magic, and that our technology can be trusted, and it's going to make their lives automatically easier. And when we work on software, we have to remember that the people who use this software are in some cases, literally putting their lives in our hands, and we have to do our work according to their expectations, and not just the expectations of the people who are hopefully paying us to do it. Really, the main problem is that the stuff that traditional engineering courses call safety critical systems, power plant software, your medical devices, public infrastructure, they are not the only safety critical systems anymore. In some ways, everything could be thought of as a safety critical system. If you can control the lights in your house and the locks on your doors from your phone, if you can order a car ride from a stranger on the internet, or you can buy a cheap new pair of glasses from a website, these are all things that interact really deeply with our everyday lives in one way or another, and they all have the potential to end in disaster. This is where we have to pull out the what if. What if the app that controls your house could be hijacked by a criminal who uses it to unlock your doors and take all of your things and kill everyone that they find? What if the ride that you call from your cool ride-sharing app uses a map that leads you and your driver down through a dangerous neighborhood and then your car is attacked? Or what if the app allows profiles by unregistered drivers and you end up in a traffic accident? What if the glasses that you bought online use a form that didn't record your eye prescription properly, and when you wear the glasses, you trip over something lying on the floor and you fall down the stairs because you couldn't see properly? The software that we work on, even the small things, they can become such a crucial part of the lives of those users that I think that we have a professional responsibility to take those lives seriously. A lot of you at this point are probably thinking that I am being needlessly dramatic. And you're totally right. You cannot think like this all the time. It's not realistic. The first thing you think when you start to pen test someone's network isn't, oh crap, I could kill someone. It's probably, oh awesome, I could pop a root shell on this box. For better or worse, however, this is the way that I think about stuff pretty much all the time because I have an anxiety disorder and this is what my brain chemistry does to me. And this is a real problem when you cooked dinner 3 hours ago and you go out to the cinema and you're like, what if I forgot to turn the gas on the stove off after I finish cooking and it fills the house with fumes and then my dogs are dead when I get back? And then you have a panic attack at the movies for reasons that nobody understands. And by you, I mean me. But the dogs are fine, by the way, and they're also adorable. Anyway, you can't live like that all the time. And this is why I take medication that balances out the chemicals in my brain so that they stop doing that. And why I speak to a therapist who helps me to undo a whole bunch of thought patterns that end with, and then everybody dies, and replaces them with something that's a bit more useful. But the cool thing is, and this is why I'm actually really grateful that I get to be me, even though my brain likes to throw all of its serotonin in the bin like it's a 12-week-old sandwich in the office fridge. The cool thing is that this tendency to immediately arrive at the worst possible conclusion about something is actually what makes me good at my job. I find bugs really, really fast, and I design really awesome fault-tolerance systems, and every machine that I use is hardened like up to 11 because I'm always assuming the worst about literally everything. I sit around in analysis meetings with BAs and devs and testers and everyone and ask lots of what-if questions about business logic so that some bugs get fixed before they're overcoded. I run my code through a million kinds of tests and I get it reviewed a lot because I know that there's going to be stuff that I've overlooked or stuff that I didn't know that someone else will know better. And then I learn things and then my code is better and then I get to make all kinds of new mistakes. And the other reason that this is cool is because this stuff means that I get to work like an astronaut. So let me explain. The Canadian astronaut, Chris Hadfield, who's that guy who played David Bowie in the International Space Station, was awesome. Anyway, he talks a lot about how astronauts are taught to think before they go out into space. Literally everything that you do in space has death as one of its outcomes. Most astronauts are previous test pilots, and there's so much training that they do to make sure that that when they wake up from blacking out from G-force with their plane plummeting to Earth, their reactions to that situation are muscle memory. Astronauts study the problems of the past, and they try to think of every negative outcome that they can. And then they test and practice and test and practice so many times until emergencies are boring and until they know exactly what to do without even thinking about it. Hadfield calls this the power of negative thinking, and I think that he explains it best in his own words when he says, "Self-help gurus are always advising us to think positively and envisage success, but it is about as helpful as thinking about cupcakes. Just thinking about them isn't going to help. It's more important to think about what could go wrong with a mission. Visualize failings, not success. That is what is essential to survival as an astronaut." Now, most of us are probably, sadly, not going to get to go to space or be test pilots, but if you are, please come and talk to me later because I want to know about it. But we can still work like astronauts and think like astronauts. We just have to do it on land. So this is how you become a land astronaut, like me. Firstly, you've got to put on your black hat. So here's a quick story about the phrase black hat. In InfoSec, we talk about white hat and black hat hackers. White hats are hackers who find bugs and flaws for the public good, and black hats are hackers who find bugs and flaws mostly maliciously or for their own gain. And these terms came from the way that filmmakers used to signal that characters were good and evil in old Western movies. The good characters would wear white hats, and the bad characters would wear black hats. And this here, what you're looking at, is one of the original black hat cowboys from the 1903 film The Great Train Robbery. Anyway, this is a fun fact. You might need it at pub trivia one day. So I recently gave a version of this talk to a whole bunch of business analysts and product owners. And in the conversation that we had afterwards, they started talking about black hats, even though I hadn't mentioned hacking at all. But they were talking about Edward de Bono's black hat from his book, The Six Thinking Hats, which some of you've probably heard of. De Bono is a psychologist. Anyway, in his book, he talks about how to plan complex work and solve problems by pretending that you're wearing a series of different colored hats. These represent different types of thinking. And when you're wearing that color, your thinking can only be about the type of thinking that is represented by that color. He recommends limiting this to a few minutes per hat. So you've got blue, that's the big picture thinking. White means just thinking about pure facts. Red means thinking only with gut feelings and gut reactions. Yellow is optimism. Green is creative thinking. And then you have black. The black hat stands for discernment. Logic applied to identifying reasons to be cautious and conservative, practical and realistic. I realized that black hat thinking was what I had been learning how to do since I started managing my anxiety, and it was also basically the same thing as what Chris Hadfield had been talking about with astronaut training. For some people, especially if you're an optimist, you've got to work up to black. For me, I had to work my way down to identify actual realistic reasons where my usual disaster thinking could be useful. So to work like an astronaut, you've got to put on the black hat. You identify all the practical reasons to be cautious and you mitigate your concerns as best you can. Secondly, never underestimate a bug. De Bono, in his book, he only ever intended black hat thinking to be one way out of many to look at your work. Having a mix of perspectives just generally is the best that you could possibly have. But we can't just throw out the negative ones, which we often want to do because we're taught that negative stuff is not nice. It is important not to dismiss the value of this type of mindset just because you arrived at these conclusions because you were doing a thinking exercise that dealt in negative extremes. And the reason that our brains worry about this kind of stuff and get anxious and think of these worst case scenarios just generally, even when they're not as full on and relentless as what my brain does. This is because this kind of thinking is useful and practical when it's used realistically. Our ancestors developed it because if you didn't have it, you wouldn't take steps to avoid the bad thing and you would die. Obviously, brains like mine will take something like this to unrealistic extremes. But these extremes are where I would encourage you to start. Brainstorm totally ridiculous outcomes, like what happens if an elephant smashes through the door of the office and tramples all of our servers? Okay. And then scale it back a tiny bit. You'll probably find some real outcomes that lead to really useful questions and more exploration. So what happens if someone creates a distraction at reception and then they use that to get an accomplice to run in they steal data from the servers or they pour water on them or something, I don't know. And then from there, you can step back a little bit more and have a totally useful conversation about OPSEC and the physical security of your data. Make a note of the likely looking worst case outcomes and then either make strategies to deal with them, if that's your responsibility, or make very strong recommendations to your clients and highlight the threats for them if that's their responsibility. And another thing is, if you're building software and you're tracking your work in any way, you'll probably have a list of small tasks and annoying things that you're going to get around to eventually. But make sure that eventually happens. Set aside an afternoon a week to fix an annoying but seemingly inconsequential bug, or to patch or decommission that one machine that everyone's forgotten about and no one cares about. Use these kinds of tasks as learning opportunities for newcomers to your team. Because these boring things that don't seem to really matter might, in the end, have disastrous consequences. Like, if someone had taken an afternoon to add support for the Dotless Eye and Turkish phone software, two more people might be alive. And never say never. There's always someone or something that is going to be that edge case, so make sure that you take the time out to cater for them. This is why it's important to remember that the people who use your software are actually mostly human people, just like you. I find that if you aren't a negative thinker by default, like me, it can be really hard to keep this perspective in view a lot of the time. And that's because the scale of most kinds of normal software disasters, like hundreds of millions of accounts breached, that kind of scale is not something that our brains were built to handle. We immediately think of that number in the abstract, and we disassociate the real impact of a software failure. So when doing a land astronaut-like thinking exercise, it can really help to put human faces to these extreme consequences, like I did earlier in the talk. The tech community as a whole has a regrettably long history of shaming these people, of shaming our customers. You know, acronyms like PEBCAC, a problem exists between keyboard and chair, they have been kicking around since the 70s. And Oren Shaw's talk on contempt culture earlier today covers all of this far better than I can with the time that I have, so please watch the recording of that if you missed it earlier today, because it is great. Anyway, the reason why these people cause us problems circles back to what I said earlier. They trust us, or they want to trust us. They think that we can perform miracles. They've been sold the idea, thanks marketing, that technology can change their world. And so when the software isn't fully usable, or it's full of holes, or it leaks their information, or it locks them out, of course they're going to be annoyed. So when we do our work, we have to remember that we're trying to do the best possible thing for them. And when they offer feedback, we should listen, as hard as it is sometimes. Again, our brains aren't built to handle large-scale concepts or to feel emotion for people that we don't know much about. We have a one-to-many relationship with all of them. Thanks to marketing, they think that they have a one-to-one relationship with us. And a lot of the time, these people using your software are in some ways actually going to have some kind of relationship with you. They might be the guy standing next to you on the train, or the person who makes your coffee, or your parents, or your children. If we're behaving ethically, we are not doing what we do for the glory of seeing our name listed as the author of a bunch of CVEs. We're not doing this to be a total rock star. We're not doing this to get the most Twitter followers. By and large, we're doing this for the benefit of other live, actual human beings. A quick way to remind yourself of who your work is actually for and who it's going to impact is to switch up the words that you're using to talk about the people who use that software. While you're working, try not to talk about users or clients. Try and talk about people. If you write Agile-style story descriptions or if you're tracking your work in any other kind of way, you can literally find and replace that word. Changing the words we use for things can be a really good, strong way to shift the way that we think about something. So, this is the recipe for working like a land astronaut. Put on your black hat, don't underestimate any of the bugs, and have some respect for the users. Remember that they're people. Now that we have the three ingredients for being a land astronaut, here's how to do some land astronaut work. You can turn this kind of thing into a team game as a fun exercise for a Friday afternoon when you're too tired to do any other type of work, or as a strategy to get unstuck or find new ideas or new solutions to a problem. To get you started, think of the one mistake that you could make in your job where someone could die. It doesn't matter how outlandish this is, but go there. This is your starting point. And then scale back from there. This kind of exercise is going to vary depending on what type of work that you do, but it is useful in lots of ways. So here are some examples of quick land astronaut exercise starters. So if you test pens, you might want to use this strategy to make a list of the worst possible outcomes for every single one of your findings for a client. And then combine these things with the knowledge of the client's domain and bring these more into the realm of possibility so that they inform the recommendations that you make to them. If you're in charge of defending networks, draw out a map of your system on a whiteboard and spend some time brainstorming the absolute most horrible things that could happen as a result of a breach of every part of that system. See what spills out. If you're a developer, make a list of all of the libraries that your work depends on. Go through them. See if any of them have any known remote code execution vulnerabilities in them. Or take the OWASP top 10. Think of the absolute worst thing that could happen in every single case for all of those. If you're an analyst, you could do the same kinds of thought exercises with business logic. Look for the loopholes that will eventually become software bugs, and then highlight them so you can then form strategies to deal with them and work out a less messy way to accomplish the same thing, and then the code that contains the bug doesn't get written. But don't forget that sometimes people literally die for really ridiculous software reasons. Let this inform your work and remind yourself of it every now and then. Astronaut thinking is one of the, I think, the most useful thing in my toolbox. But, you know, like all tools, it's not the best thing for every single job. It's the kind of thing that I can take out and use deliberately and strategically and with precision at specific times when it's appropriate. Because brain chemistry, I had to learn how to stop doing this all the time. But what I'm hoping here is that some of you who don't do this by default will learn how to use it strategically so that it can be really helpful if you give it boundaries, and it will make you better at your job. And then you get to call yourself an astronaut, and you can help make software more secure and not die. So have fun.